This is far outside the realm of.
Banned assault weapons now.
Migrant crisis is stretching far beyond the southern border. From Chicago, where immigrants are sleeping in a police station.
Underneath the bridge, top is sprung a leak. And the animals I've trapped have all become my pets. And I'm living off of grass. And the drippings from the ceiling. It's okay.
Hey folks, so we're out here and we're gonna do a little filming and covering essentially the equipment and gear list for Orion training groups, small unit maneuver and small unit sustainment classes. We're gonna break down the videos by the different levels of kit, focusing primarily on items worn and the ruck. And if you're new to here, I'm Blake Flannery. I did 20 years in the Marine Corps, 17 of those as a Force Recon Marine. So without further ado, let's kick this thing. So let's start with items on the body, the things that you're actually gonna be wearing pretty much on or right next to your skin. So working head to toe, right? Some kind of cover, hat, if you will. Now, what you wear is obviously going to very much be dependent on what it is that you're out to do and, you know, what your job is. So what I have set up out here is essentially the same thing I wore doing reconnaissance and surveillance patrols out in the bush. So that's why I have a bush cover. It's always a good idea to have some kind of soft cover whenever you go out in the field, even if you're gonna be primarily wearing a helmet, because when you take that helmet off, it's good to have something camouflage to put back on your head that's not super hot and keeps you concealed better, right? Bush covers are a little bit better than a ball cap because you have the 360 brim that helps break up the outline of your dome. And then you also have these tie-ins. You can add scrim, you can add veg to it, things like that. Inside your soft covers, a good amount of them will come with some kind of signaling material on the inside. This is only really good for near range recognition. I could take this, hang it on a tree next to the trail. I back off from the trail, and then when the unit I'm linking up with walks by and stops, then there'd be another signal, and that'll alert them to my position. But it is something, and it gives me more use out of the simple bush cover. All right. Now, if you're gonna run a helmet, obviously you wanna make it as streamlined as possible. And the big reason you're gonna need a helmet, if anything, is gonna be for wearing night vision, right? There's different systems that are out there. Not gonna go too deep into that, but if you need something better than a simple boonie if you're gonna be running night vision. So that'll kind of change things, how you pack that out, and that'll be a discussion for another time. Moving down from there, right, with what you wear on the top. For your undershirt, you want it to be a moisture-wicking material. That goes for your undershirt, and if you wear skivvies, then you want a moisture-wicking material that's gonna help pull that away from your skin and not to stay swampy. So cotton's really not a great idea in really any environment. You can get away with it and very hot and arid environments. However, you're still better off with a material that will wick that moisture away from your skin and aid in the evaporation of it. Especially if you're in a cold environment where being wet and cold is gonna put you at greater risk of a weather injury, right? Over that, you're gonna have something like a field jacket, or you might just wear a combat top. Combat shirts are great if you're gonna be in body armor out in this environment and for simulating, you know, the reconnaissance and surveillance mission. The combat top underneath the chest rig won't work out as well because that material will get snagged on all this underbrush and it'll just lead to damaging that garment sooner. And in most cases, your combat tops are a monotone color around your trunk, whereas your field jacket has a full camouflage pattern, and that just aids in breaking up your outline and your blending with your background. So I recommend a field top when you're gonna be out in the thick of things, but if you're gonna be wearing body armor, then the combat top is definitely much more comfortable to wear. Moving down with your pants, again, you have combat pants or you have regular field pants. So I've got combat pants on, right? The big difference between them is usually gonna be, there's gonna be less elastic material in your field pants. The pants will all be usually the same camouflage pattern. So these have the black on the elastic. You may have a different pocket layout depending on the pants you get. That's not super important. What you definitely want to look at are cargo pockets. In the field environment, cargo pockets are awesome because you can put things into them as needed, hence the name cargo pocket. Now, a lot of people don't like carrying things in their cargo pockets that are big, heavy, and bulky, and I would agree with that. You don't want to load these things out as your primary means of carrying things. But as I strip off my gloves, if I had a scarf on, or even if I take my soft cover off, I can cram all that in my pockets until I need it again, and then I put it back on. So cargo pockets are definitely a big thing to have, whatever kind of pants you decide to use. Again, field or combat trousers is not as big of a deal when it comes to deciding between a combat shirt and a field shirt. But if you're worried about going to thick brush and the elastic on your combat trousers are getting torn up, then you might choose to use normal field trousers that don't have that weaker elastic material on them. Going down to footwear, talk about our next to skin is the socks that we choose. So merino wool socks are going to do really well at managing your temperature. When they get wet, that moisture can wick away and you won't lose any of the thermal properties of the sock. So cold weather, that's a big consideration, but even warm weather, it's nice to have. And then good footwear over those socks. Now, socks definitely want to be higher up. Even if you're going to be tucking your trousers into your boots or wearing gaiters, anything like that, because that does aid you with more protection up the leg. As far as the boots go, right now I'm just wearing low top hikers. I have Keens because I have a nice open toe box so I can get natural toe splay in the foot. I prefer to go with low tops as often as possible. And then if I'm worried about vegetation things getting up inside the trousers, then I can just throw on a pair of gaiters or anything like that. But from all my experience, it's really not that necessary. If you are worried about insects, again, you can wear boots that are tall enough that you can tuck your trousers into them. The military style of using an elastic blousing band works for making it look nice, but it doesn't actually keep out things like ticks. So if you're really worried about that, you can tuck them into your boots. And either way, whatever you choose for your footwear, you want something that has good tread on it. A lot of barefoot shoes, although being very good for your feet, don't always have the greatest tread when you start going off trail and they get caked with mud and anything else like that, you're gonna start losing your purchase on the terrain. So a more aggressive tread has been my preferred over the years. All right, whether waterproof or not, I generally go for not, because non-waterproof boots will dry out faster. You know, the real name of the game is drying out versus trying to stay dry. So with socks, again, you want them to be about calf high. You can go up to the knee. That way you have more protection against any kind of critters or sticks and things that poke up through your pant leg if you're not, you know, tucking it into your boot. And then you also want to consider your thermal protection for a colder environment, so a taller sock. I prefer tall socks and shorts for base layer, even in cold weather environments, because the more I cover, the more I'm going to end up sweating. So I don't mind leaving a little bit of exposed skin that'll be covered with some other layers to protect me from the elements for base layer. With the shoes, I really do recommend you find footwear that has the open toe box and starts following more that barefoot style. Something to consider though with all that is, if it is a barefoot shoe, a lot of them tend to not have a very aggressive tread on there. And that will get you through a lot of environments, especially if it's very flat. But when you start going to places that have a good amount of topography and muddy ground, those flat and not so aggressive soles aren't gonna work out as well with you trying to scale the terrain. I did a jungle patrol years and years and years ago, and I was wearing some old worn out Oakley assault boots that didn't have a super aggressive sole to begin with, and they were worn out and almost like moccasins, and it was a very painful 2 days in the jungle trying to scale up the sides of the hills. So definitely stick with more aggressive tread. I prefer low top shoes, lightweight shoes, and I definitely prefer non-waterproof to waterproof in majority environments, because it'll dry out faster through activity. Your socks should keep your feet warm. If you want a very cold weather environment, then you would want to look at having waterproofing on those boots to help prevent the intrusion in that very cold environment. So know your environment and use the appropriate footwear for it. All right, so now real quick, gonna go back through and just gonna pull out the kind of limited pocket items I have and go through the nut ruck and kind of the whys behind it. So one thing I always carry in the pocket is compass, right? I prefer a lensatic compass because it's what I was primarily trained on in the military, but they're rugged. This one has tritium filling, and I like to carry it in my left shoulder pocket. I know there are a lot of people prefer to carry tourniquets up there, and that's fine. It's not super important about where exactly you carry things, as long as it makes sense and it's accessible to you, right? My other pocket over here, for now, I just have my phone. Just didn't want to leave it behind in the car. A lot of times what I used to normally carry was a handheld GPS in this other pocket, so the phone's just kind of taking that placeholder. I prefer not to carry anything in the breast pockets. That way, if I choose to wear a combat shirt instead of a field top, I don't have to find a new place to carry whatever items are here. They're available if I want to stuff something in them, like any kind of sensitive items, smart cards I might have to carry, but for the most part, things go down to the fanny pack or cargo pockets, because I'll always have cargo pockets, I'll always have a fanny pack, and I always have shoulder pockets. So that's why I choose to run it that way. Before going to the fanny pack, covering actual pocket items, I have navigation kit. All right, it's got all my nav tools, some reporting tools, and of course, I've got my map. So I carry a bit more when it comes to navigation items and all that on a reconnaissance patrol. So I have this whole pack and it sits in my cargo pocket. Last other little pocket items is a folding knife, right? Not super important about what it is, as long as it is robust enough to last you in the field. And then, as much as I love knives and I don't mind spending money on a good knife, you might not want to spend top dollar on super fancy blades, because the bush will eat them, right? And then in my back pocket, carry a multi-tool. If you're only going to carry one knife out with you to the field, I would highly recommend it's a multi-tool like this. It's not the best knife, it's not the best pliers, it's not the best screwdriver, but it does the okayest job of each of them, and it can limit the amount of tools you actually carry, right? This is really important, and I always keep it accessible, like in this back pocket. So if I need to access it quickly, like maybe I have a bolt override with my weapon, I can use this tool to help me clear it if my normal methods aren't working. All right, so moving on to the nut ruck, right? I always include the nut ruck in the items on the body because I'm always gonna have this. So if I ditch everything else in an evasion situation, I'm still gonna have what I'm wearing clothing wise, and then the nut ruck or the fanny pack, all right? So this contains a lot of field craft items and some other pocket items, because again, I don't want them all loose and out there. So some things you can have in here, right? Always good to have a lighter, and then with a lot of things, you can pre-wrap them in some 100 mile an hour tape, right? Or rigger tape if you're in the Marines. And that way you just have lengths of tape out there with you without having to carry a whole roll. I've got sunscreen and lip balm all rolled into one, all right? This little plastic sleeve is where I would put my ID and one of my dog tags, carry it with me on patrol. Here I've got bug wipes and rehydration salts. Carry those in here. I've got some optic wipes. So for my weapon optics, or depending on the weather and the environment, I might have eye protection on, and that helps keep them from fogging up. Hearing protection. Always a good idea to have hearing protection on you. You know, these are kind of bulky, being in this plastic case, so you can just carry the packs of the foamies. I just find these to do a little bit better than foamies when it comes to riding in helicopters and things like that. And then a little lens rag. Now, one of the things to think about when you're packing out your nut ruck here is, I obviously don't want to just fill empty space to fill space, but I also need to pack this out so that I don't have items that are all super loose. If I just had the sunscreen and the lighter in there and I'm walking around, if I jump, I fall, those items are gonna bounce off each other and make noise. So even though some of this stuff I could definitely shove in the ruck, it's not something I need to have on my person. It just kind of helps fill some of this out. All right. Now in here, I've got more field craft items and repair items. We'll just take this off and make it easier, and you don't have to keep looking at my junk, just the junk that was on my junk. So some stormproof matches, right? Having some redundancy in the ways that you can start a fire if need to. Now, for my purposes of being a recondo, we weren't overly concerned with being able to start fires, because a fire gives off a lot of energy, both light and heat, and there are ways to hide that, but our biggest concern would be moving to a pickup point. So I have some means that'd be good enough if I really needed to start a fire for survival. All right, sewing kit. Again, this is something that could go in your pack. However, a lot of these items can double up, and I can use these to fish in a survival situation if I had to. Signal mirror. Signaling is always part of your survival kit. I have a couple of small water bladders that can be filled up. So those rolled up, they're about, I think almost 2 quarts of water for each of them. They come in the old issue survival kits. So I've got two of those. I can fill those up with water and then purify it somewhere else. I have some electrolyte tabs so I can help myself stay hydrated in a survival situation. Here I just chose to place another compass, somewhat of a backup, and then These flat compasses are good for map work. I have some riding implements, right? Riding reports, marking things. All right, riding implements are good. Length of 550 cord, and it's orange because now that I'm retired, I wear this when I go hunting. So my length of 550 cord is orange. And same thing, I have this notebook, which is also orange because I primarily now wear this when I'm hunting, and I prefer to be more high vis because I've been shot at by hunters in the past. And then the last thing I have in here, this is where I keep my electrical tape. I do not keep electrical tape on a carabiner on the outside of my kit because all it will do is attract dirt, get caught on things, and it doesn't need to be on the outside of my gear, right? If you're worried about having immediate access to tape, again, you can wrap this around some other items, like wrap some electrical tape around your rail of your rifle or someplace else if you are sure that you need like immediate access to this, but you don't need to hang it off your kit. And the back side of this guy, I have a handkerchief in orange that I can use as a signal panel, and it has some helpful tips. You know, if you weren't super trained in survival, this has some tips for you. So I have that just in case I completely lose my mind. And then inside this kit, I've got a lot of different things: fire, signaling, water purification, procurement, building shelter, signaling. Everything I really need for survival is in this tiny little thing right here, right? So everything else that is in this nut ruck is redundancy, right? Two is one, one is none. And it's redundancy because I can use all the items in these two main packs and I'm not concerned about the what if. This back here, that's my what if. If I had to go into evasion and survival, those are my what if tools. Should I lose, break, or consume the items that are in this main pouch before I get to that survival situation? And then if I'm in that survival or evasion, it just gives me more so that I can thrive more than just survive. So we went through, you know, the items worn on the body, and we're doing this whole series of videos again in support of Orion Training Group's small unit maneuver and small unit sustainment classes. We're teaching these classes, holding them open enrollment to the public, and it's not to militarize the populace, but what it is about is giving people the knowledge and the skills that they can then take and continue their training on their own and with their own communities, but getting people to be more self-sufficient and not just relying on services to be provided by the government and living in kind of a shell of false security in the comfort of your home. To be able to get out here in the woods, being able to orient yourself to where you are, conduct at least basic levels of land navigation, understanding cardinal directions, and then how to move as an organized group from point A to point B over the terrain. And then the small unit sustainment class takes it further, and we will actually stay out in the bush, and it's about how you can actually sustain yourself out in the field, both by being adequately prepared beforehand and then maximizing the use of the terrain and the land and everything available to you in nature to keep yourself out in the field. And it's not about surviving, it is about thriving in that environment. Because if you can thrive in austere conditions, in crappy weather, in rough terrain, then the little things that happen in your life back in the first world stop causing you so much anxiety, because you realize that they're really not that hard to figure out.